Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, the Mobil Corporation, Essex Chemical, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, and the Friends of Firing Line.
It's been a while since we looked at the United Nations, and not since the appointment of our ambassador, the redoubtable Vernon Walters, successor to Jean Kirkpatrick. The UN is less and less in the news, and the best explanation for this, I suppose, is that it is in most ways by which these things are measured powerless. And of course, it long ago ceased to be an informative moral gauge by which to evaluate the conduct of its members. Still, the organization goes on, and some, like General Walters, who is well aware of the UN shortcomings, urge us not to give up on it. Vernon Walters is perhaps best known for his versatility and experience. He is profoundly gifted as a linguist. He has served every president of the United States since Truman. He is uncannily there when anything important happens, on the spot when Harry Truman met General MacArthur at Guam, with Vice President Nixon when he was assaulted in Caracas, decorated by General de Gaulle and General Eisenhower at the same time, military attaché in Paris who arranged the secret meetings between Henry Kissinger and North Vietnam's Le Duc Tho, survivor of the Watergate scandal because it was he who refused to do the bidding to issue illegal instructions in the field. General Walters entered the Army as a private and emerged as a Lieutenant General. He is the author of several books and numerous articles, and now is here to tell us how we are doing in the UN. Our examiner, Professor Ernest Vandenhaag, is the John M. Olin Professor of Jurisprudence and Public Policy at Fordham. He is uniquely qualified to probe almost any issue, but he has just completed a book along with John Conrad called The UN In or Out. More about Mr. Vandenhaag in due course. I'd like to focus on two points, since we can't comprehensively evaluate all the concerns of the UN. The first is the fiscal reforms and their bearing not only on economics but on policy. And the second is the UN's performance on human rights with special attention to its vote on Cuba. But beginning with the first, Mr. Ambassador, you've been quoted as saying that the reforms undertaken during the past 6 months or so are the most important in the history of the body. Tell us, if you will, what those reforms are.
They are also the first reforms. There haven't been any before.
There have been some bad ones. For instance, the right given to the General Assembly to take over if the Security Council bogs down, right?
I wouldn't call that a reform by any stretch of the imagination. I would call that a pit into which it fell.
So you define reform only as getting better?
That's right.
Okay. Okay.
Why? What has happened? Well, before we had a budget for every 2 years, completely uncontrolled. The first thing you have to remember about the UN is the 159 members, there are about 45 democracies. So you've got to understand that the language spoken there is not the language of democracy. It's the language of the one-person state or the one-party state. And the budget to them was a theoretical business that you added Christmas trees to and made it unrealistic. Let me give you an example. At a time when 1,000 people a day were dying of hunger in Ethiopia, they proposed to build a $73 million convention center in Addis Ababa. This at a time when the United States was giving more food to Ethiopia than all of the rest of the world put together. We thought that was wrong. We have now got a budget where that is not possible. There is a contingency fund built into an overall ceiling which cannot be gone beyond. That's the first thing. The next, we have to have a consensus for the budget. No longer can we be outvoted on the budget. If we don't like the budget, we refuse our right to the consensus and the budget doesn't go into effect.
We refuse to the extent of our participation, or do we have a veto
power?
No,
we just say that if it isn't agreed, we just don't pay. Mm-hmm. It is a veto power in a sense, but everybody's got it. But everybody knows that if they don't come to a consensus which the United States can accept, then we go back to zero with the United States withholding its funds without which they can't operate.
Now, this has had what effects, or is it too early to tell, on sobriety in the formulation of policy and debate?
Well, not yet. It hasn't gone into effect yet. Right now, they're discussing the budget at this moment. What it has had in its effect, for instance, is that the Secretary General, on his own initiatives, took measures that cut the budget by $60 million. To give an example, we had 83 assistant and undersecretary generals, all of whom earned more money than a U.S. cabinet minister. Well, we decided to go
and
to
tax-free.
Huh?
And tax-free?
No, they pay a tax assessment.
Oh, they do?
They pay a tax assessment. It's not as big as an American tax, but they pay a tax assessment. We're now down to 60. So that's about a 25% cut. We've also cut down the use of consultants. We've cut down the use of wasteful conferences all over the world. We've had made a lot of changes.
Well, I think a lot of people are in favor of economizing in the United Nations, but I don't think really under the aspect of the heavens, the amount of money wasted by the United Nations is what is principally offensive about it. So can you predict what changes in policy are inherent in these acts of economy?
They're gradual. The first thing I have to tell you is when I went there, my instructions from the president were don't kill it, reform it. Mm-hmm. And being a devout Reaganite, I've attempted to do that. Mm-hmm. And I know you found it a dangerous place, but I'm not sure it is as dangerous now as it was then. If I can just point out what's happened since we've been there, and you say the question of the voting against us. Well, you know, when the Congress votes something I don't like, I can't refuse to pay my taxes mm-hmm. just because I don't like it. But since I got there, or in the last 24 months, not because of me, but because of what Gene had started and we have continued, we got for the first time in the United Nations, I was authorized as the President of the Security Council to denounce terrorism by whoever committed, for whatever reason committed, and wherever committed. But you're right, the press doesn't print this. Secondly, we got a resolution condemning hostage taking, saying that hostage takers should be extradited and brought to justice. There's none of this one man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter. That's gone. We got more votes to condemn the Soviet Union for its occupation of Afghanistan than ever before. And when I got there, where they said we're at rock bottom.
Yeah.
No, we had 124 last year.
Is it?
The same on Vietnam and Cambodia. However, in neither case is either country mentioned. Whereas when I got there was a resolution on Namibia that condemned the United States 9 times. That same resolution this year has no condemnations of the United States. We got a resolution endorsing the right to own private property, the right to engage in entrepreneurial activities. I don't think we've done all that badly.
Now, when you say you got a resolution, it was something that the Third Committee handed on up to the General Assembly, and they confirmed.
Mm-hmm.
Now, talking about the whole subject of reform properly used within the General Assembly, you've been extremely outspoken and, from my point of view, extremely eloquent in describing the unique, the incarnation in Cuba of a complete travesty of human rights. I think you have said that per capita it's the most militaristic country in the world. Or did you say now that Nicaragua has exceeded it?
Well, I think Nicaragua has exceeded it probably now.
And then on top of that, it seems to be vindictive beyond most totalitarian states. Valladares was there for 22 years in prison and so on and so forth. Now, what I want to know is why after 25 years of this should it be hard to condemn Cuba?
Well, it shouldn't be. Mm-hmm. And one of the so-called non-aligned is the one that fouled us up on this. It wasn't the Soviet Union, it was the Indians mm-hmm. who introduced a typical resolution saying, let's take no action on this. We lost by one vote. But as the Cuban patriot Martí said, a lost battle is a commitment to win the next one. We're going to win the next one. If we don't win that, we're going to win the one afterwards. But the fact remains that Cuba has had a free ride for 25 years. Now, Chile and Cuba have the same population, roughly 10.5 million. Oh, there are resolutions condemning Chile right and left. No resolutions condemning Cuba. What are the facts? The facts are that in Chile, if you want to leave, you go to the station and you leave, or the airport. There's no law to prevent you to leave. In Cuba, there's a law against illegal immigration. There are 5,000 Chileans in political exile. At the wildest outside figure, there are 1,500,000 Cubans. And we're talking about countries with the same basic population. I think that indicates the degree of the repression to some degree. And they've been having a free ride. In the United Nations, when I came there, we had a special rapporteur for human rights in El Salvador, for obvious reasons. We had a special rapporteur for human rights in Guatemala, for obvious reasons. It was perceived as friendly to us. Now, and we had one for Chile. Now we've got one for Iran. We've got one for Afghanistan. We've got one for religious persecution. And I'm hoping we're going to get one for Cuba and Nicaragua. At least we're going to fight to get one.
And tomorrow, the Soviet Union?
Tomorrow, the Soviet Union.
Well, let me ask you this, Mr. Ambassador. The United Nations was conceived as a kind of a paradigmatic force. That is to say, it had all these elevated principles, and people were supposed to measure the differences between how they conducted themselves and how these principles said they ought to conduct themselves. But here we are after 37 years, whatever it is, trying to figure out a way by which we can persuade this paradigmatic instrument to condemn Fidel Castro's government. Now, are we therefore engaged in a massive education trying to educate the United Nations, whereas it should have been the other way around?
The United Nations was built in a moment of euphoria just before victory in World War II, and it was going to prevent the return of the scourge of war, which twice in the lifetime of the signatories. Didn't happen that because one nation, which had promised free elections in Eastern Europe of all non-Nazi parties, totally misinterpreted the use of the words democracy, people's elections, and so forth.
Distorted rather than misinterpreted, right?
Well, they never intended to do it in the first place. Mm-hmm. See, when you talk with a Soviet about human rights, what he's talking about is the right to housing and medical care and education. He's not talking about what you can say, do, and think. Mm-hmm. It has a different interpretation to him.
Yeah.
They never intended to let anybody opposed to them vote in Eastern Europe, but we naively didn't understand that. There was the belief that Uncle Joe would become a good guy when the Nazi threat was removed. Because of that, and because of the constant use of the veto by the Soviet Union at a time when there were only 51 nations, the United Nations was to use a Spanish word, which we should have in English, but don't, desprestigiate it. Mm-hmm. It lost prestige and therefore could not be the effective instrument. The long-term goal is to lead them back to being once more something that vaguely represents the conscious, the collective conscious of mankind. But remember, we're only talking for 44 countries who are democracy, 45. So it's a long road, and I don't expect to see the end of it or anybody else. But for better or for worse, it's very important to people all over the world. People often say, let them leave. They'll go to Moscow and they won't like it. They won't. They'll go to Geneva or Vienna or somewhere nice and they'll love it. Mm-hmm. And then there'll be a forum in which we will have no voice to speak to us. And to speak for us, and as an old soldier, I don't like to give up terrain by default.
No, well, I wasn't advocating leaving the United Nations, but although maybe Mr. Vandenhaag has come to that conclusion, I'm advocating doing whatever can be done to relieve us of the burden of the illusion that it is a teaching moral body. Now, if you have votes asking people to condemn Cuba for failure to observe human rights and you lose, you're much worse off than if you didn't have a vote in the first instance.
We didn't lose.
Well, you lost by one vote.
We didn't lose by one vote. What we got was the approval of an Indian motion saying, let us take no action on this. The issue of Cuba was never brought to a vote. And if we bring it to a vote, we'll win.
Well, it's nice to hear that. But I guess what I'm saying is that the parliamentary structure of the UN gives it certain judicial verisimilitude that actually acts against our best interests. If you consider it an open question whether Cuba is a free society or is not, then you're doing epistemological harm to the processes by which basic truths are learned. I don't think it's all that easy to blame it all on the Soviet Union, is it?
As an academic approach, the real world is quite different. Everybody knows what the UN is. They know that the so-called non-aligned vote against us 82% of the time.
You know,
Cuba is non-aligned. Nicaragua is non-aligned. India is non-aligned. Everybody knows what these terms really mean, and nobody takes them seriously in their literal sense.
Well, shouldn't you distinguish, General, between India and Nicaragua? Nicaragua
Yes.
is a satellite,
yep.
And India isn't at least
no,
yet a satellite.
No, India is not a satellite.
Yeah.
India is the largest democracy in the world.
Right.
But for some reason that I've never been able to fathom, they have decided that the Soviet Union is either the wave or the future, or it's in their interest to snuggle up to the Soviet Union. They forget that the first people to harass the British about setting them free were us, long before World War II.
Well, you remember that Nehru refused to join protest against the Soviet Union for invading Hungary in 1956, so it's a long tradition. But let's take simply as an example of Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
Mexico is not a satellite of the Soviet Union. And Mexico voted with us 14% of the time last year.
That's good. They voted with us more than the Soviet Union did. That's rare.
Now, wait a minute. You're making a very arcane point here. The how often does the Soviet Union vote with us?
The Soviet Union votes with us about 12% of the time. So you can see how close it is.
So what is it that should make the United... what is it that should make Mexico as unfriendly, as hostile to us in our foreign policy? That's question number one, to which I would conjoin, what are you trying to do about it? And are you profiting or not from what Gene Kirkpatrick tried to do about it?
Well, the first thing I would say is that I once said to a Mexican president, I said, our relationship with you is the most difficult in the world. He put his hand on my shoulder and he said, you understand. And I said, yes, I know why, because every Mexican kid, when he opens his history book, reads, they took half our national territory. And that influences people.
Mm.
I said, when you declared independence from Spain, you took half Spain's national territory. But nevertheless, there's that thing, there's a popular dislike of the gringos and so forth. And of course, one of the problems we have in Latin America is with 50 years of racket, we all got our independence together. We've gone somewhat further than the others. That can only be due to our craftiness and evil intent,
mm-hmm.
which must be resisted.
Well, what you're doing is suggesting why traditional bias can affect the country. On the other hand, we live in an age in which the civil rights resolution almost overnight substantially broke a traditional bias against blacks in America when General de Gaulle, in a matter of 3 or 4 years, was able to meet in peace and harmony the leader of a resurrected Germany after two world wars. So what is it that's distinctively wrong with Mexico, using it simply as a synecdoche?
Frankly, it baffles me. I don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
Everything should connect them with us. What it is you have this so-called non-aligned running around the world who are about as non-aligned as I am.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody's competing for the leadership. The Chinese want to be the leaders of the third world. The Indians want to be the leaders of the third world. And Mexico wants to be the leaders of the third world, if not of the third world, then of the Hispanic world.
Yes.
Or the Latin world.
Right.
And this is the problem. And they're all outbidding one another to obtain that leadership.
It's like
wanting to be captain of the Titanic.
Sure. leadership is defined as being most conspicuously anti-American, is it?
I would say that's not far from right, but you understand that you are a linguist, that there are very few languages in which there's a word for leadership. Most of them have to use the English word.
There isn't one in Spanish?
No.
Liderismo won't do, huh?
Huh?
Liderismo won't
no,
do.
No, liderismo and lideranza are Anglicisms.
I see. Well,
caciquismo comes closer.
Yes, yeah, right. Well, let me ask you this then. What of a concrete nature do you as ambassador do when a Mexico votes against us under preposterous circumstances? Now, there was one famous vote 7 or 8 years ago where they voted that Israel was a racist state.
Zionism equals racism.
Yeah. And the next day they lost 3/4 of their tourist business. So the day after that they decided it wasn't a racist state after all. So that was a very quick recovery.
First nerve is the most sensitive nerve in the human body, despite what other people might think.
Yes, that's right. Now, Mrs. Kirkpatrick began addressing letters, as I understand it, to individual ambassadors saying, why did you do that? Given all the nice things we do to you, why did you do that? What do you do?
Well, I give them verbal hell. The interesting thing about Mrs. Kirkpatrick's letters, which I found fascinating, is three countries wrote in to protest that they had not received a letter from her, even though they had voted against us. They felt discriminated against. What do? I try and point them out that it's not in their long interest. Well, one of the ways I say to them, supposing a meteor struck North America tomorrow, destroyed the United States, how would you estimate the chances of human freedom surviving to the end of this century and your freedom surviving to the end of this century? You know, when they come after me on aid, I said, look, we're spending $300 billion a year on defense, so you cannot spend that money.
Yeah.
I said, we spend $120 to $150 billion a year to keep forces in Europe, and it's worked. There has been the longest period of peace since the Battle of Waterloo throughout the world. I don't believe in beating them over the head publicly. I believe in beating them over the head privately where they're not shamed if they have time to reason about it. Mm-hmm. I travel a great deal because the changes of votes I want, I don't get from the delegates here. I get them from the governments at home. And that's where I go for my votes. And I submit the voting record has not gone downhill since I arrived.
Well, I recognize that it has not. But let me ask you this. Since we tend to lose decade after decade on these votes, why do we bother to vote? What's accomplished by voting, especially when the negative affirmations are so frequently made by these votes?
I have never been impressed by children who, when they didn't like something that was going on, stamped their feet and said, I won't play anymore.
Well, aren't you impressed?
I don't think we as a great nation should do that.
Aren't you impressed by children who refuse to participate in a rigged game?
Yeah, but when the game has to go on, regardless, a game is a game. We can't stop the United Nations by not participating in it.
No, I'm simply saying this is not original with me, but James Burnham 20 years ago,
I read it,
made the recommendation that the United States appear in all the debates, vigorously answer questions, exchange bribes, threats, conceits, but refuse to vote. It seems to me if you did that for about 3 weeks, all of a sudden the vote would lose its significance.
When I came to this job, I consulted all 10 of my living predecessors. None of them recommended that course.
Well, and they were, couldn't it be that they, having lost so consistently, they perhaps felt that they wouldn't want you to be the only person who won?
I don't want to make an impression. I want to change voting patterns.
Well, you know something? This show's been on for 21 years, and I guess you must be the sixth ambassador from the United States who's told me exactly the same thing. Mm-hmm. And I don't doubt the sincerity at all, mm-hmm. but I think that the body public is entitled to a certain impatience with the lack of progress.
They are, and I'm conscious of it. I get 1,000 postcards. I've been getting 1,000 postcards a month, all of the same color and format, saying get the United Nations out of the United States and the United States out of the United Nations.
Oh, yeah.
I must tell you that the last month I got 69. Which is a great drop in that.
Well, either that or a great lesion of interest in the UN.
Well, that there is, unquestionably. All my predecessors got tremendous publicity when they made a speech there. I must say that I have become accustomed to getting no publicity. I called a press conference on Cuba and nobody printed any.
Well, now, how do
it was
you
like going to a war, it didn't take place.
How do you account for that, since you have a certain characteristic vigor in the way in which you express yourself?
I can't. Account for it.
You can't account for it. I see. I thought you meant you can't speak that vigorously in public.
No. I don't think I've ever been accused of speaking mildly.
No, not in anything I've ever read.
See, you haven't heard though.
Well, you say yes, the American people are entitled to be impatient, but no, they mustn't do anything about it.
No, they didn't say that.
Well, they've drawn in the purse strings a little bit. We began by touching
that. We've
done
more than drawing in the purse strings.
What else have we done?
Well, we've made a point to them. For instance, if they have some pet project they want us, I can't discuss this easily in public.
Oh, sure.
They want to get somebody elected to some job, or they want to get some project underway, or they want to have something done. I make plain to them that this may be quite difficult.
Yeah. And are you sufficiently coordinated with national policy to make that threat, if you like, realizable?
That's one of the advantages of being a member of the cabinet and ambassador to the United Nations.
Yeah. Now, there was a...
I have the right of recourse to the president if I want to exercise it.
Right.
Although, generally, obviously, I believe the United States can only have one foreign policy, not two.
There was a quarrel over that I read at the time, that the Secretary of State thought that the ambassador to the United Nations should not have a cabinet seat. But that problem went away?
No, it didn't. The president decided that he should.
You said the problem continues?
No, it doesn't.
Well, I asked you if he went away, and you said...
No, the president's made the decision, and the seat is there.
I see.
And I sit in it, and I'm going to Washington on Monday to attend the cabinet meeting.
Yeah. So that there you have an idea of the extent to which you can convincingly protest a putative act against us by a United Nations member by threatening a cut in aid or whatever?
I don't ask for instructions unless I find them indispensable. The people that can give them to me are very busy with other things. I try and see what the framework of policy is and harmonize myself to that. But I don't pick up the phone and ask Washington what I'm to do on every small issue.
Well, can you pick up the phone to Washington and say stop the check to Brazil?
No.
Brazil needs all the money.
No, that would involve Treasury, so that's what I'm doing.
Yeah, right. So therefore, it's really a matter of suasion. And your principal regret is that you're not talking sufficiently to the American people. And is that because of this total absence of interest in the United Nations?
I wouldn't say it's total, but it's very hard to get any interest on it. Nothing really violent or exciting ever happens there. And the newspapers are looking for something juicy. You know, when they suddenly discover that perhaps there wasn't any law breaking in the recent activities, there may be a sudden loss of interest in it.
Yeah, right. So in that sense, you suffer from your victories.
Well, I wouldn't call them victories. I don't want to be dramatic. I mean, I haven't turned the United States around, but I intend to move it more than it's moved so far.
Now, if you had it in the spirit of being Atchison and being president of the creation, if you had had it in your power to redraft the Constitution of the United Nations, what does it occur to you first that you'd stick in there?
I don't really know. You know, there are certain provisions I would like to give teeth to it, but then if you've got a majority against us, they could use that against us.
Yeah.
So it would require a wisdom beyond what I possess.
That's what Dean Atchison discovered in the late 50s.
The chance of changing the Charter of the United Nations is, I think, only the only thing I know more difficult than trying to change the Constitution of the United States, which has already been amended 25 times. I don't know whether the Charter of the United Nations has ever been amended.
Well, they have been substantive, we won't use the word reform because that's controversial, changes. When we dominated the General Assembly and figured that they'd vote with us every time, we proposed that if there was a deadlock in the Security Council, the debate flow over to the General Assembly. That was a very bad mistake, was it not?
That was one of our moments of insanity.
Yeah.
Now, national insanity. We've had several.
But wouldn't you call that the equivalent of a constitutional amendment?
I don't know whether it's the charter was changed in consequence, which is a technicality.
Well, assuming that I'm trying to put this in non-melodramatic terms, you don't want to engage the question, should the charter be changed, because you say it's not going to be changed. Suppose there was a nerve gas that put everybody to sleep, and as we all woke up, we decided, well, let's have an international organization, and you were tapped to be one of the founding fathers. Would the new organization have in it something substantially different from the present organization?
I'm torn there. To be effective to prevent war, it would have to have a delegation of sovereignty from the independent nations, and I'm not sure that they would want to give it, and I'm not sure that as an American I would want to give it. So I'm afraid the Lord's going to have to do that, not me.
So that, for instance, you couldn't imagine us having command over an international military force?
Well, we are in NATO, of like-minded nations, all of them democracies, which have a single common objective.
Talking about the international organization.
Well, I think, you know, as long as you've got it, 82 so-called non-aligns voting regularly against democracy, it would be difficult to do that.
Okay, before we call on Professor Van Hoy, let me ask you this question, which you're probably bored of hearing, and I'm bored of asking, but I've never heard anybody tell me anything terribly interesting about it. What is it that makes the Soviet Union appeal to the Third World?
I don't think it's so much the appeal of the Soviet Union. I think that appeal has greatly decreased. I think if you look at the African countries today, for instance, on the Cuban issue, five African countries supported us. Five African countries supported us as against one Latin American country on that committee. The Soviet Union hasn't got so much an appeal as the United States' success and freedom provoke jealousy. I don't know whether that's interesting, but that's my interpretation.
Well, no, it is interesting. The Soviet Union does not provoke jealousy. Why, given the fact that it's extremely powerful?
The Soviet Union is a developed nation only in arms. In other areas, it's an underdeveloped nation.
So,
and I think what Gorbachev has tried to realize that, and he's trying to make it a developed nation, and that's a laudable purpose if he succeeds.
Yeah. No, I think you're 100% right. But let me ask you this. Why isn't there a more natural hostility to the Soviet Union, given that it is so rankly imperialist in its practices?
There is, but it's more dangerous than being hostile to the United States. Being hostile to the United States carries almost no sanctions.
Yeah.
being hostile to the Soviet Union, you don't know when you're going to have a riot or a disturbance or arms or a civil war or something in between. That's what happened in the case of the Cuban issue. A lot of our Latin American friends were told in no uncertain terms what would happen if they voted with us.
It's the business of complain, get even. So the Soviet Union, in effect, exercised continuous intimidatory tactics against any country that stands in its way.
Well, I think not the United States, it doesn't.
Yeah.
Or in some of the other larger democracies, it doesn't either. I think that's a fact of life because it's a country in which decisions can be made by a very small group. Decisions of an extremely serious nature can be made by a very small group. And the lessons of Poland, of Hungary, and Czechoslovakia are there to show that they are prepared to use force to project their power wherever they want to. Not to mention the guerrillas in Venezuela against which the Venezuelans, Castro supported guerrillas in Venezuelans. That's the whole importance of Nicaragua. I'm not afraid of Soviet missiles. I'm afraid of the fact that the Soviets can tell our allies. The United States is incapable of preventing the establishment of a Soviet client state 1,000 miles from Houston, and that's why Nicaragua is of vital importance to the United States.
Our examiner, Professor Vandenhag, is the author of the recently published The UN In or Out. He is, as I have said, professor of jurisprudence and public policy at Fordham, having taught at the New School, at NYU, at the University of California, at Columbia, at Yale, at Vassar. He's a naturalized American citizen with advanced degrees in law, psychoanalysis, and sociology, and the author of numerous books. Mr. Vandenhag.
Let me ask you a question, Ambassador Walter. Let me quote from Mr. Roosevelt's Secretary of State, Cordell Hull, who said this about the United Nations, then about to be born. No balance of power, no spheres of influence, no alliances, none of the traditional forms of diplomacy will be necessary once there is that international organization. Now, your former colleague, Abba Ibn, criticized this in the following terms. This is a sure competitor in any contest for the most absurd utterance made since the invention of language. What I'd like to know is whether you agree with Abba Ibn or Cordell Hull.
I'd agree totally with Abba Ibn.
It's an easy one.
This is an unbelievable element of naivete. I find it hard to believe that in the light of the intelligence which has been pouring into the US government since the middle of World War II, anyone could seriously believe that.
They called him the hillbilly Polonius.
No comment.
All right, let me ask a further question. Since World War II, we had about 150 small wars, some not so small. In any of them, do you perceive that the United Nations was at all useful in either ending or preventing such a war?
Only if they involve small countries.
Which ones?
Well,
which war has been prevented?
They were helpful through the Organization of American States in ending the football war between El Salvador and Honduras. They were helpful in bringing the fighting in Kashmir to an end. They were helpful in bringing some of the fighting in Cyprus to an end, yes. But those are small compared to the hopes that were expressed in 1945.
Yeah,
but if you ask that, what use is a baby? You know, you got to wait a while and see.
Well, most babies grow up. Do you see any chance that the United Nations will?
I do, but it's in the midst of very premature adolescence.
I see.
Not that I have anything against adolescence, you understand. I went through it myself.
Let me ask Mr. Buckley, you have some experience in the United Nations. Do you have any use for it? Do you think it can be useful in anything except stopping football wars?
Well, I never expected that it would stop wars. I think it's a useful place within which, as I mentioned a moment ago, to exchange bribes, intimidations, threats, seducements, endearments. And I think some of its technical agencies are useful. Somebody's got to decide who owns 300 megahertz or whatever you call it, and where it stops en route between here and Canada. I think some of those things work pretty well. My objection to the United Nations is the implied moral leverage that its parliamentary votes have. That's about it.
Surely, Mr. Buckley, you know that technical matters have always been settled without the United Nations, postal unions, various agreements on such matters as you have mentioned, have been made before and without the United Nations. And my suspicion is, in fact, that the United Nations has a tendency to politicalize them and make them more difficult rather than less.
As in UNESCO?
Yes.
Yeah. I would defer to Ambassador Walters. It's been a long while since I was there, and you could probably tell me whether some of its technical organizations successfully accost problems that were not accosted, say, pre-League of Nations.
Well, the first I must pick up, you mentioned several times it's a good place to exchange bribes. I must say that during my total stay there, I've never been given any money to bribe anybody. You know how the U.S. Congress is.
You have negative bribes. You cut off money if they
That's
don't
blackmail,
do
not bribery.
Oh, sorry. I should have said blackmail.
You know, General de Gaulle once said of the United States, he said that American Puritanism doesn't prevent the Americans from sinning, it simply prevents them from enjoying their sins. And it's so correct. I think some of the things, like for instance the UNICEF, the Children's Fund, has been very effective. The World Health Organization has had programs of immunizing people and so forth that have been very, very helpful. But UNESCO, when I discovered that UNESCO was spending 82% of its budget in the city of Paris, and I mean, you know, UNESCO is designed to help the third world. And none of us who've been to Paris really regarded it as part of the third world. But the real thing that drove us out, and I always remind my colleagues in the press of this who criticize us for it, is that they prospected an idea called the New Order of Information. Well, that's exactly what it is. It's a new order of totalitarianism, which means government control of the press, and there's no way we're going to go along with that. And one employee of UNESCO, I'm told, who was expelled by the French government 3 years ago as a spy, is still receiving his UNESCO salary. So you can see why the U.S. was not anxious to pay any particular contribution to UNESCO.
I certainly would agree with you, but when we left UNESCO, we decided that it couldn't be reformed because the cards, so to speak, were stacked against that, largely for the reasons that you mentioned, that most of the United Nations members and most of the UNESCO members are anti-democratic and pro-Soviet. Hence, every vote is, in effect, rigged against us. We may, with your efforts, get a few more votes than we would otherwise get, but on the whole, the majority is against it, which is why we basically left. Isn't that a good reason for leaving the United Nations, too?
No, it's no more reason than I, as a Republican, would have, because the people continually elect Democrats. Does that mean I should no longer vote in the congressional elections or vote for a Republican president? I don't think so.
But Ambassador Walters, when the people vote, each person has one vote. And
the five permanent members of the Security Council have more than one vote, but go ahead.
But when we look at the United Nations, we find that small states, which have hardly any number of inhabitants, have no power, etc., can simply outvote the United States.
Well,
in other
true.
Words, it's not a fair vote in which we say, well, we lost, we have a chance to win next time, if we can try, but it's a rigged vote.
Well, and you know, there are a lot of rigged votes, I understand that, and I propose to go on until we can unrig them.
Well, how do you propose to do that? You will make the 82 so-called non-aligned nations democratic?
Fortunately, they themselves are beginning to realize some of the facts of life. For instance, last year we had a special session on the critical economic situation in Africa. Now, in the early days, what their idea of development was a steel mill with a production of 10 million tons for which they had a market for 100,000. They have now decided that number one priority is agriculture, number two priority is health, number three priority is housing. Now, that's a change from before. And gradually, by a process of elimination, they're going to discover how often we're right. I'm not saying the United Nations is perfect. When I was asked when I went was appointed to this job, I said I'd give it 6 out of 10. After I'd been here 6 months, they asked me would I give it, and I said 5 out of 10. I'm back to 6 now.
Well, I think you just mentioned that some of the undeveloped nations in their economic policy learned from experience.
But it's long.
It's long. But do you know of any anti-democratic totalitarian state that has learned from experience in such a way as to become a democracy?
Well, A great many of the right-wing totalitarian states have ceased being totalitarian.
They're not totalitarian. No, I would not agree with you. Excuse me. I would say these, such as Franco.
No, but I could live with the Soviet bloc and the anti-totalitarian stations. If we had the other nations on our side, we'd have an overall. We could even reform the United Nations Charter if we got them on our side. And a lot of them, you know, what they say publicly and what I say publicly and what they say to me privately are quite different things. On the Libyan issue, when we were condemned for bombing Libya, most of the people that voted against us came to me privately and said, "We're so glad you did this."
I think that's interesting, but I do not see wherein it speaks in favor of the United Nations. Let me ask you this in a different way. All I have heard you say, and I think I've never heard a more able defender of the United Nations than you, was basically that it leads to an exchange of opinions. People get together, they have contacts, etc. Why couldn't that be done in the nearest coffee shop more cheaply?
Well,
if you think, for instance, of the Cuban missile,
they prefer the rather more expensive restaurants, which I couldn't afford as a private citizen.
Well, all right, we'll give you an allowance, perhaps, for that. But it still would be cheaper than the United Nations.
But it would
and,
be,
and much less illusion creating,
but it
much
would be
less
much
pernicious.
More disorganized than even the United Nations to do
I
it that way.
It wouldn't be organized against us. Let me point out, for instance, the Cuban missile crisis was solved, to the extent to which it was solved, without the United Nations, of course, and literally in a coffee shop originally. Coffee shops are useful. I'm not so sure I would say that about the United Nations. Now, let me ask you something else. You did mention that you have been successful by an appropriate combination of pressure and incentives in changing some votes. Please tell me, why are these votes important to begin with?
Because whether we like it or not, a large part of the world mistakenly perceives the United Nations as the parliament of mankind. And that's why it's important that we not just turn our back and pull away.
That's
it is
my
not
objection.
The parliament of mankind.
That's my objection.
Well, let me ask Mr. Buckley on that. Much of it, let me put it this way, seems to rest on the idea that there is some such thing as world opinion, which we must try to influence through the United Nations. Actually, the United Nations tends to influence it against us, but let that go. Is there such a thing, you think, Mr. Buckley, as world opinion, considering the fact that opinion formation is free only in a rather small minority of democratic states?
Well, I think Ambassador Walters made an admission against interest when he said that time after time people come to him and say, "Thank God you bombed Libya," having just gone and voted resolutely against it. A chief of government in Western Europe who will be unnamed went to Henry Kissinger about a year or so ago. He said, "Do you know what would happen if the Marines landed in Nicaragua?" He said the president of Mexico would lead 2 million Americans down the Paseo de la Reforma protesting this latest act of imperialism. And then he would retreat to a little chapel, if he could find one, and get out on his knees and thank the good Lord for the American Marines. Now, the point that you make, I think, is that people wouldn't act as perversely as they are required to act precisely because they have an ostensible and very ostentatious parliament of man in which to act out their hypocrisies. So if we could confine them to talking to Ambassador Walters and not to voting, we would have cracked the problem of the parliament of man, wouldn't we?
Let me ask Ambassador Walters to comment on that in these terms. Don't you think, Ambassador Walters, that the United Nations is no more than an institutionalization of general hypocrisy? And if so, why do we support it?
Because we support it domestically. There's no reason why we shouldn't support it on a world scale.
It is a little different, domestically.
That was
further
an ambush,
deponent,
wasn't it?
Further deponent saith not.
We do have a democracy domestically which does require or permit a good deal of hypocrisy. I can't disagree with you.
Well, we also have
but there are other things
well,
in
we
a democracy.
We also have occasional auto da fes, as Senator Hart.
Right, we
so
do.
So we don't always support
and
hypocrisy.
Basically, our decisions, even the hypocritical ones, are made by common consent, democratic consent, which, as you certainly admit, is not the case in the United Nations. So I don't really I don't understand the purpose of the vote. I don't think it's all that harmful either. I don't think the United Nations is basically public relations rather than a diplomatic institution, fine. But why are we paying for it?
Well, that's a question that could be answered, and I would simply say that if you could put it down to something that might be conceivably useful, the United States contribution is $209 million, and with 234 million Americans, that's about 80 cents per person per year, and it's less than the cost of the Sunday New York Times, and I'm not sure it's at least equivalent value.
Well, that's a difficult question to decide. I will agree.
I didn't attempt to decide.
But you see, when I purchase, and I must admit to that, the Sunday Times, I do it voluntarily. I don't give a penny voluntarily to the United Nations. Furthermore, the Sunday Times has some nice pictures.
Oh, the United Nothing Nations has beautiful song. Pictures in the hall. You should see them. And it has a fantastic gift shop.
Well, now we are coming down to brass tacks.
It has coffee shops, too.
Oh, it's got a delegate lounge. I remember one very high U.S. personage who said to me, the United Nations is a cesspool. And the next time he invited me to lunch, where did he invite me? To the delegate's lounge at the United Nations.
Well, I think now you have put your finger on the actual usefulness of the United Nations. Still, I wonder if what we really want are the pictures and the coffee shop, etc. Don't we rather overpay for that? I'm not speaking only in financial terms. If you look at the fact, I have written this book, The United Nations In and Out, with a friend and colleague of mine, John P. Conrad. Mr. Conrad, unlike myself, is totally convinced that the United Nations will save the world. If he were alone, I wouldn't have written a book with him. But he stands for a very major segment of American public opinion, and of the American public. Whenever something goes wrong, so why don't we ask the United Nations to do this? Now, you are aware, but I still would like your comment on it, that the United Nations is basically impotent. In other words, each nation retains the power, and as a matter of fact, legally the right, to go to war whenever it wants to. The United Nations is no more than all the nations together, with a bit of bureaucracy added. The United Nations has no power to prevent even a minor war, unless the two parties want it to be prevented, and that's of course not the case in major wars. So what it is really good for, other than the coffee shop, etc., etc. I think it's an amiable organization, although against that you will have to halt the impediment to traffic in New York, the misparking, and all kinds of spying.
Plus the $800 million that the United Nations personnel here funnel into the economy of New York City. But go right ahead.
Well, they get value for that.
For $800 million?
Oh, yes. I think they get it too cheaply, for all I know.
Well, it's a difference of judgment, clearly.
Yes. I think there's a parochial interest on the part of New Yorkers, but I don't think there's an interest on the part of taxpayers.
The money doesn't stay just in New York. It goes into investments all over.
Look, I don't think really it's
we're wandering afield.
It's not terribly profitable to pursue the economic point because it's de minimis.
Yeah, sure. It's not. But still, the basic point is, why are we doing it? Forget about the economics.
It may work.
How?
It may work. It may gradually, by becoming more reasonable, acquire the kind of prestige that will enable it to do a few of the things that the drafters dreamed of.
Well, now
it's already lasted twice as long as the League of Nations.
Yes. I think that it's major achievement, lasting.
In the current world, surviving is important.
I think it's important if the survival of an organization is useful. I have my doubts that this is the case. Now, you say it may go into usefulness. I'd love
You've
to
already decided it isn't. I have hope.
Well, yes, you're more optimistic than I am, and I wonder why. You see any serious signs? Now, you know as well as I do that each nation is sovereign. There is no power about the nations, above it. The United Nations is not a supranational organization.
I've said that.
I fully agree with you. It's an international organization How can it grow?
Well,
to what?
Let me give you a simple example. If you take the nations of the NATO alliance, they vote with the United States. A paragraph between 95% in the case of Great Britain and 33% in the case of Greece. Let me assure you that in the case of the Warsaw Pact, the only variations are at the third decimal place between their vote and the Soviet vote. In fact, there are 19 nations in the United Nations that vote against us more often than the Soviet Union does. And just because something doesn't work the first time, you know, when we signed the Constitution, Vermont and the state of New York were almost at war. And if we'd looked at that and said, what's the use of trying to get these people together in the same country? They're practically using force on one another. The difference is I'm an optimist and you were less optimistic than I am.
But
I'd like to come to the basis of that. The states such as Vermont, etc., were willing to give up some of their sovereignty in favor of the federal government.
Not at the beginning they weren't.
Well, they ultimately were,
yes,
as
right.
you say. Do you foresee that the Soviet Union, China, the United States, Cuba, whatnot, will give up any of their sovereignty in favor of some sort of super government? And would you favor that?
No, I would not. But I don't believe any of the regimes that you've mentioned, the present regimes, will do that. But they're doomed. They're doomed. If you look at the whole course of human history, the whole course has been upwards towards greater dignity and freedom for the individual man. Many tyrannies in the past have temporarily halted that flow. None of them have permanently halted. And these modern tyrannies, these medieval tyrannies masquerading in modern garb as progressive regimes are not going to escape from the inevitable laws of history. The principal thing we want to do is do two things, is preserve peace without looting freedom and justice. And I would cite you, for instance, one of the reasons why we preserve peace is we maintain the tremendous sacrifice of the armed forces which we support, which is the most important thing. The other thing is if you limit it to that, you've limited it to Western Europe and none of the countries would be willing to extend it elsewhere. So you've got to take what you find in place, which is the United Nations, and try and shape it into something like that.
I certainly agree with you that peace is maintained by the deterrent force of our armed forces, which is one other reason why...
And American will.
And resolution, quite. It's one other reason, and the resolution, it seems to me, is somewhat weakened by the United Nations and not strengthened. But let me come to another point. I think you are right. You are more of an optimist than I am. And I'd like to have
Mr.
Buckley.
I'm older than you are. I've been around longer.
I doubt it. I just look young. I'd also like Mr. Buckley on that. You said that tyrannies are only small episodes, short episodes in the history of mankind, and ultimately there is.
But constantly repeated, unfortunately.
I could say. Unfortunately, the same that is true about democracy.
Yeah.
Small episodes.
It's a brand new invention, with the exception of Switzerland. It was invented 200 years ago.
Well, there's something about Athens, etc.
Athens, one voter in 100. One person in 100 voted. The 99 others were Helots. Athens is not a good example.
But it still had what we call something like civil rights.
But only for a few people.
Well, it's better than for nobody.
No, but one out of 100 is not a good ratio.
Oh, I agree. But that brings us back to history.
Let's not hit and run on Athens. Athens institutionalized civic ideals.
Right.
The extent to which they distributed them is a completely different question, as we found out when the Founding Fathers refused to give it the vote to not only to black people, but to women.
Or to anybody who didn't pay £200 a year tax.
Sure. Right. Add that, poll tax, everything else.
But it developed.
Universal suffrage did not spring into being instantly in the United States.
But here's the point I think that you missed. Mr. Van Hagen is trying to find out whether there are inherent in the United Nations ideals whose fruitfulness we can have any reason to expect. And he's afraid, and I'm afraid, the kind of thing that is encouraged in the United Nations is its opposite, means by which tyranny gets a long survival, means by which you exercise hypocrisy, intimidation. You just finished telling us that the Soviet Union exercises a completely intimidating reach over 82 nations in the world. Now, doesn't it do this in part because the United Nations is a useful vehicle through which it operates?
Certainly not. It would exercise that intimidation in any case. The fact that in the United Nations, even these benighted people, even these non-aligned, vote against them in overwhelming majorities is a restrictive influence on them.
Yes, but...
And I think it's not fair.
But the United Nations confirms and validates the possibility of this.
No.
If cheek by jowl with all those exalted ideals of the United Nations. You can get away with that kind of international structure. It encourages its germination.
I don't agree. The United Nations has condemned that activity on the part of the Soviet Union, and the United Nations couldn't have stopped it. It hasn't got the power to stop it, neither has anybody else who isn't prepared to go to World War III.
Then what's the point of this condemnation? Other than if we do it ourselves, I'm perfectly willing to condemn, as you would.
Afghanistan.
But it wouldn't help. And Afghanistan, the war goes on, even though the United Nations has condemned it. In Korea, as you know, we fought under
the United Nations banner,
but it was an old-fashioned war, no different from a war that we would have fought under our own banner. So what's the point?
It wasn't really an ideological war. It served our national interest, and it prevented worse damage.
I couldn't agree with you more.
We went there under a United Nations flag, as I recall it. And if you go to Korea right now, you'll find that over the headquarters of the Eighth Army, there also flies the flag of the United Nations.
And what's the difference that makes?
The difference is it looks as if the United States is not acting alone for its own selfish interests.
So it's a matter
that is important in the world.
It is a matter of looks, you're telling me now.
All human life is a matter of looks.
Thank you, Ambassador Vernon Walters of the United Nations. Thank you, Professor Ernest Vandenhaag, author of the UN. What is it, do we or don't we?
In or out.
In or out.
It's the same.
And thank you,
I
ladies.
I already memorized it.
Thank you, ladies, ladies and gentlemen, in 13 languages. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of Whitfield High School.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, the Mobile Corporation, Essex Chemical, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, and the Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SICA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed, bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.